What exactly is completing the square, and why do you need to know it? Those are the questions we're answering today on Math Hacks. Hey there, I'm Brett, and welcome back. Today on Math Hacks, I get to show you two different approaches for completing the square. Why in the world would we do the exact same problem two different ways? Well, because we all have different learning styles, and I'm hoping that one of these methods really clicks with your brain. The first method I'm going to show you is the geometric area model method. This method is great if you're a visual learner or if you just like to conceptualize what you're doing. The second method I'm going to show you is the typical algebraic approach. This is the way you would learn it if you were taking an algebra or pre-calculus course. All right, guys, let's get started. So today we are learning how to complete the square, and we are going to start by completing the square on this equation, which is y equals x squared plus 6x plus 2. Now there are two different methods that you can use to complete the square. The traditional method is to do it completely with algebra, and those are the steps I outlined here on the right-hand side. I am also going to show you how to do it geometrically with an area model. So we're going to start with the geometric model, and then after we solve it with pictures, then we'll move into doing it with the steps I've outlined here. And of course, this is the way that you would typically do it in an algebra course. So to start with the geometric model, the first thing we need to do is to form a square. Now I'm going to section out this square so that I have a medium and a small square inside of it, and two equal rectangles. The next thing I'm going to do is to assign some of the values here in my equation as areas in this square. So the first one we want to assign is the x squared. We're going to simply assign that area as the area of the larger square inside of our square. So this becomes the area x squared. And of course, for this square to have an area of x squared, that means that its side lengths are both x. So this length is x and this length is x. Now I am going to place the area of 6x into my diagram. And I'm going to place this into the two rectangles. Now these rectangles are the same area, so I'm going to split the 6x between the two. So that means I'll have 3x area in this rectangle and 3x area in this rectangle. Of course, for this to have an area of 3x, I know that the length here is x, since I look up here and that length is already described as x. Then to get 3x here, this little side length right here must be 3. The same thing applies to this one. I know that the longer leg is x, and then the shorter leg here will be 3. Now to find the last area, I know that this smaller square has lengths of 3 and 3. So that means its area is going to be 9. So what I've done here is I have made an area diagram to represent a perfect square. I now know that the area of this large square has side lengths of x plus 3 and x plus 3 is equal to the values of the smaller squares and rectangles inside of it. So that means that this area is equal to x squared plus 3x plus another 3x plus 9. In other words, I could rewrite x plus 3 times x plus 3 as x plus 3 squared. And on the right hand side here, if I combine like terms, I get x squared plus 6x plus 9. So this is a nice perfect square. But what I notice here is that it is not the same equation as what we started with. This one has a plus 9 at the end, whereas this one has a plus 2. So what I want to do is adjust this equation so that the right-hand side matches our original equation. To do that, I need to subtract 7, since 9 minus 7 will give me 2. And remember, whatever I do to one side, I have to also do to the other side of the equation. So next, I'm just going to subtract 7 from both sides. Now that I have the right-hand side matching our equation that we started with, I know that this equation on the left-hand side then is an equivalent form. So this is the equation with the square completed, and it is also in standard form. Just by looking at this, I can tell you where the vertex is. It is the value being subtracted from x and added on the n. So that means that the vertex for this equation is at negative 3 and negative 7. And we'll talk more about this in the next lesson where I show you how to graph a parabola from the equation. But just as a little tiny preview, you can start to recognize that these are the positions where you would find your vertex. The sign will always be opposite on the x value and identical on the y value. We also can tell that because there's no number being multiplied out in front of this parenthesis, this parabola isn't stretched or compressed at all, and it isn't flipped upside down since there is no negative value out in front. Of course, those are things you're all going to learn in the next lesson, so if it sounds a bit foreign to you right now, don't worry. Our job in this tutorial was to learn how to complete the square, and we did that geometrically. Now let's go ahead and use these steps I've outlined on the right-hand side to solve this same problem again algebraically. As we solve this problem using purely algebra, what you're going to notice is that a lot of the steps that we have here are going to tie directly back to what we did when we created the area diagram and manipulated it to get our equation into standard form. So the first step is to separate the x squared and x terms with a set of parentheses and leaving a blank space in those parentheses. So what that means is that I'm going to take this equation here and I'm going to simply start by rewriting it. And I'm going to write down a set of parentheses. And inside those parentheses, I'm just going to write the first two terms, the x squared term and the x term. And I'm also going to leave a little bit of extra space inside these parentheses because we'll be filling in that space in one of the next steps. Now on the outside, I have just this constant hanging out. So plus 2 is out here. This is very similar to what we did when we started this equation. Remember, we just placed the x squared and the 6x terms inside of our diagram, and we didn't place the constant at all. That was left to just be adjusted at the end. And that's kind of similar to what we're going to be doing here. Step 2 says to take half of the coefficient on x, square it, and add it to the blank. So what that means is I'm going to look at my x term, read off the coefficient, which is 6, take half of 6, so that'll be 3, and then square it. So 3 squared is 9. And I'm going to place 9 here inside the parentheses. Now that 9 should look really familiar. That was the value, of course, that we found in this little square when we multiplied its area out. This number right here completes out the expansion when I multiply x plus 3 times x plus 3. All right, now we're on to step 3. Which says subtract the value found in step 2 from the constant on the outside. So here I have a plus 9, and I'm also going to subtract that 9 from the outside. The reason I need to do that is I need to make sure that whenever I'm adding or subtracting numbers into my equation, I am not altering this equation. I don't want to change it. I want it to stay consistent. All I want to do to it is rewrite it in a different form. So because I added 9 to this equation, I also need to subtract 9. Now, your teacher may have taught you to do this slightly different. So don't be confused. If your teacher says to set your equation equal to 0, move the 2 over to the right side to have negative 2, and then add 9 to both sides. At the end, your teacher would have you move that constant back over and rewrite it as an equation. That is just an alternate way of doing this step. All right, so our last step now is to factor the quadratic inside the parentheses, and we need to subtract these two values on the outside. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. Of course, this here factors into x plus 3 squared. We already know that because when we made our area diagram up here, we saw that x plus 3 times x plus 3 was x squared plus 6x plus 9. So we already know that this will factor into x plus 3 squared. And if you have added the correct value here, you should always get a binomial squared as your factorization. Then on the outside, I just took 2 minus 9 and we get negative 7. So that's very similar to what we did in this step in the geometric approach, where we adjusted the 9 so that the equation would match our original. This is the same as our solution from the geometric method. As you can tell, once you get the hang of the algebraic approach, it's really only a couple steps and you have your equation changed to standard form. But I really like using this area model when you're getting started, so you get an idea that, wow, we really are completing a square, like a physical geometric square. For our final problem of the day, we are going to complete the square with the equation y equals 2x squared plus 8x plus 11. And this one is a more difficult equation because I have this leading coefficient here. So instead of just having an x squared, I now have a 2x squared, which is going to slightly change how we're going to attempt this problem. The first thing I need to do though before I make my area model is I want to get rid of this 2. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to rewrite this equation with the 2 divided out or factored out in front. So what I've done here is I just pulled out a positive 2 from every term, and even from this 11, which doesn't divide nicely, so I just wrote it as 11 halves right now, but I also might think of that as the mixed number 5.5 if I need to. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to do the area model just for this equation on the inside, and once I solve it there, I'll go ahead and replace it back into these parentheses and multiply it by 2. So first I'm going to create my square. I'm going to put the x squared area as the larger square and divvy up the 4x area between the two rectangles. I'll fill in the corresponding side lengths and compute the area of the smaller square, which will be 2 times 2 or 4. So what I have found here is that this larger square has an area of x plus 2 times x plus 2. And it is equal to the sum of the areas of its smaller parts, which are x squared plus 2x plus 2x plus 4. This can be rewritten as x plus 2 all squared and x squared plus 4x plus 4. All right, so the last step here, of course, is to make this equation match this equation here. So here I have 4, and here I have 11.5, which is the same as 5.5. So I need to add 1.5 to 4 to get 5.5. Now that this equation matches the inside of our parentheses up here, what I want to do is multiply everything by 2. So I basically want to plug this guy back into the parentheses for my equation. So I'll have y equals 2, and then instead of x squared plus 4x plus 5.5, I'm going to write in the x plus 2 squared plus 1.5. Lastly, I'm just going to distribute the 2 through to both of these terms. So I'm going to multiply it on this term, and I'm going to multiply it with the constant on the outside. when I multiply this 2 with the x plus 2 squared, all I need to do is really just attach it to the front of these parentheses. So I'll have 2 times x plus 2 all squared. And then I'll have 2 times 1.5, so I have a plus 3 on the outside. And this is the equation with the square completed. All right, so now let's do it the algebraic way. And there are a couple little things you need to pay attention to make sure that you don't make any mistakes when you have a leading coefficient. We'll begin the exact same way that we have been with these algebra-only problems. We're going to go ahead and insert a set of parentheses around the first 2 terms, leaving a space and the constant on the outside. Now here's where it varies, and this is really important. Before I take half of the middle term and add it, I need to factor out this leading coefficient. So I'm going to factor out a 2 from 2x squared and 8x. So when I divide 2x squared by 2, I get x squared left on the inside. And 8x divided by 2 is 4x on the inside. Now that I have this 2 factored out, I can continue as usual. I'm going to take half of the middle term. So half of 4 is 2. And square it, and 2 squared is 4. Of course, I want to keep this equation balanced, and since I added something on the inside of my parentheses, I need to subtract that same value from the outside. Now, the tricky part here is I'm not going to subtract 4, I'm actually going to subtract 8, because notice that this 4 has a 2 being multiplied to it, because this 2 would be distributed through the entire parentheses. So on the outside, I am going to subtract 2 times 4. Now I'm going to go ahead and factor the inside of the parentheses and do this computation on the outside. 11 minus 8 is 3. Our final step is to write x plus 2 times x plus 2 as x plus 2 squared. There you go. We have completed the square. As always, thank you so much for joining me on Math Hacks. Remember, your support means the world to me, so give this video a big thumbs up if you learned something new or if you just enjoyed it. As well, don't forget to click that subscribe button to join our community and get more Math Hacks in your feed. Till next time, I'm Brett, and good luck studying.